Pastor KKK, Pastor Kiroko. Let's welcome our brother. He has come on for us today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Our God is real, and He is real, and He is in the house to meet your need, to meet my need, and to minister to all of us. Amen. Let's give a mighty clap unto the Lord. And then just enjoy the presence of the Lord. You may sit down. I bring greetings to you from Atlanta, Georgia. My wife and my family and the church family, they know that I'm here today and they are praying for us. They have been praying for this time when I get home and meet my family members. You indeed are a part of me and I'm a part of you. If we have not met before, I think it's because you have been doing something and you have been elsewhere whenever I am home. But I thank God that today God has given us an opportunity to be together and share the word of the Lord. For those that do not probably remember my names are Karumba Kamau Kiroko. If you hear somebody call me Kamau, they have actually known me. If you hear somebody calling me Karumba, they have actually known me very deep. And the Kiroko, they have known me as well. And I thank God for this moment that God has given us to be back home. I always say when I come here, if I don't come here, I feel I have not gotten to Kenya yet. This registers to me that I have gotten home. I feel this is my place of encounter where God literally almost met me and molded me. I was informed, then I was transformed. I was informed, then I was transformed, and then I was formed in this place. That means in my making and in my growing, the Lord has been very faithful in this place. The Lord, as the bishop has said, gave me a wife a few years ago. And those few years ago, the Lord blessed us with three children. And those children are blessed of the Lord because the Lord had given me a responsibility. And I thank God for the journey that we were walking as young people. Because the word of the Lord was reminding us that when He gives us families, it is a heavy responsibility to raise up a godly seed. Not only to raise children, but to raise up a godly seed. And therefore, I thank God. And between me and my wife, the Lord gave us three children. And between my children now, because the Lord has increased me, and the Lord has prospered me. Let me tell you, there is always a secret in going. There is always a secret of going out of your very comfort zones. There is a secret of believing God for what you do not know and it is not familiar. The Bible says Abraham believed God when he heard the voice of God and went. And when he went, it was counted for him as righteousness because he believed in God. Who would lead him and bless him? And so today as I stand before you, I left with five members of the family. And now we are increased. Now I am a grandfather, a biological grandfather of four. And so I am a young man, seasoned, and with grandchildren. Amen? And then I got an extra son and an extra daughter. So I left with one daughter, now I have two. I left with two sons, and now I have three. And that is the blessing of God. Amen. Amen? Amen? Now I want us to go to the word of the Lord. Because if you believe this word of the Lord is going to enlarge your territories. The Lord will enlarge your borders. The Lord will open your eyes of understanding that you begin to see the inheritance that is hidden in Christ Jesus. And it will be benefit, the benefit of your family, and you are kindled. This morning, I want us to receive first two testimonies of men that walked with the Lord Jesus Christ. And they testified. One of them is called Brother John. Brother John says, this message about Jesus Christ and all that is said in the bus. You know, on the 15th of June this year, I was born again. And it was news. Did you hear about it? It was the news buzzing in the social media. Anybody heard about it?
Yes,
They heard about it. That I was born again by my last born son called Daniel. And I was born in Canada. And it was great news for me. I thought everybody should know about it and hear about it. Because to be born a second time, to be born a first time in Canada, a place that I did not belong, it is wonderful. And so I thought everybody in the media, it should be everywhere. But thank God for those that have had it. And so John says this thing about Jesus Christ. We have heard it, we have time tested, and we have known it is true. Because they have walked the walk. In the book of 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4, the Bible says this. Whomever is born of God. And I would like us to start from verse 1. If you can get the scriptures for me, I would like to use the screen. In the book of 1 John, chapter 5. Okay, we start from verse 1 so that you can get the context. Whoever believes that Jesus Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him will be God, also loves him who is begotten of him. By this we know that we are the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And this is the commandment. And his commandments are not burdensome. For whomever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world, but who believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Jesus Christ is provided for us as a means and a way for us to connect with our Heavenly Father. And the Bible says, he who believes in God, he who believes in Jesus Christ, and he who believes in the one that begot him, now that one has already known God. And because he has known God, the Bible says he's an overcomer. My question is, why does John go into the aspect of being an overcomer and overcoming the world? Because in the world, there are many tribulations. In the world, there are many challenges. In the world, there are many things that come against your life. There are many things that come against your job. You go to a job and there is a gun already against you. You start your business and there are people that are already lined up to wreck your business. You are raising up your children and there are barons, there are drug barons, and they are trotting in the neighborhood selling drugs to your children that even before you know, your children are in a bad company. There is a club, a nightclub that has been opened in your neighborhood and they have begun to sell alcohol to affect your mind and the mind of your children. And this is the world that the Bible says, this is the battle that you are going to fight every day, wherever you are, because we live in a foreign world. But in the foreign world, God shows his power. God shows his might. God shows his ability to deal with those issues and care for his children and our destiny. And John says, and this is our victory. This is how we get our victory. And the way we get our victory is by our faith. But our faith in what? Because faith is not just faith itself. Faith must have an object. Faith is not a matter of just the subject, but it is the object. What is the object of our faith? The object of our faith is our faith in God and our trust in God. And John therefore says this, and this is the confidence. This is, and whoever is born of God overcomes the world. That means my brother and my sister, I come to you to tell you this, that God is faithful. faithful to overcome all your battles. It doesn't matter what battles you are fighting. It doesn't matter how many devils and demons are pursuing your life. It doesn't matter what boundaries and limitations have been imposed in your life, either by your education process, telling you that all you can become is an engineer. And there is no job for an engineer. That all you can become is a house girl, because you never went beyond a certain level, and because you need to survive. That all you can become is a shopkeeper and an employee. Whenever I interact with the Jewish people, I am amazed by their concept of life and their relationship with God. They might not be confessing Christians, but their perception about God determines their place in the society, because every time they are going to position themselves. You employ a Jew for 5 years, he is understanding you. He is studying you. He has come to study your business. If you employ him for more than 5 years, he begins to think about how he is going to start the business that you are doing. If you employ him for more than 10 years, he believes that you have made him a slave. And he hates to be enslaved, because the narrative of slavery and bondage is in the subconscious. And so because of that, because of your trust and faith in God, I am talking to you about your faith and your connection with God. That tells you, I am not in this place as on a permanent basis. I am not in my situation on a permanent basis. I might be struggling now, but thank God that weeping may endure for a night, but joy is going to break in the morning. I might be struggling with the sickness today, but I know, because I believe God, that God is going to give me a breakthrough. John says, and this is the confidence that overcomes the world, even our faith. That means in it, our trust in God. Because he who comes to God, Paul says in the book of Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6, he who comes to God must believe that God is. That means about God there is no question. About his reality, John says we have touched. And this touching is experiencing. You know, everything else can be taken away from you. Your wealth, your everything that you have acquired. But there is nothing that can never be taken away from you, and that is your experience. You called upon God, and God heard you. You cried to God when you are sick, and God delivered you. Now John says this. This is the confidence. This is how we do our business. It is by faith. Because faith is a currency through which you get your inheritance. Faith is the currency by which you receive your conveyance from God. That means all your resources, all your promises, all your promises, you are getting them from God by faith. God wants us all to be built in truth, righteousness, and have an overcoming attitude in life. The Bible says, my people perish, and they perish for lack of knowledge. And because they lack knowledge, I have also rejected them. What kind of knowledge do you want to have in order for you to have an overcoming life? What kind of knowledge do you want to have? John starts by saying this, that he who has been born of God and has believed in Jesus Christ is an overcomer. That means the challenges might be there. You might find me in battle. And you might find me, I have already received a blow, and I might be bleeding. But let me tell you, even when you see me bleeding, I want to assure you, myself, I am an overcomer. The enemy might appear like he has won. But because I know my God, I know I am going to overcome. Then comes Peter. Peter has experienced God. Peter has walked on water. And as he has walked on water, and he has received God healing people, including his mother-in-law, he has seen Jesus manifesting his glory by healing, And then he writes to us in the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, And he says,
there is a power that has been given to us. It has been deposited. If only we can harness it and experience it and use it every day. It has been deposited in us. Let us see it in the book of 2 Peter, chapter 3. In the book of 2 Peter, Peter says this, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. You need to understand who God is as you believe in him and the knowledge of Jesus Christ, because it is Jesus Christ who gives us access to the inheritance that is yours and that is mine. But how does that happen? He says this, as you do that, as his divine power has given us all things. That means the divine power of God has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Amen. All things that pertain to life and godliness. What is godliness? Godliness is understanding who you are in God. And who are you in God? The Bible says in the book of Genesis, chapter 1 and verse 26. And God said, let us create man in our own image. In our own likeness, let us make him. And what that means is this. You are not an accident wherever you are. You are the thought of God. You are the intention of God. You know, in our limited mind, we define and stereotype human beings. And we say, this one was born out of wedlock. It is like we are already defining who they are and where they should be in the society. We say, this one is from that family, insignificant. They don't even have a prophet in their neighborhood. We don't even know them. They don't even have any business. We don't understand them. But then there comes God. And he says, whomever you are, look at yourself in the mirror. Because you are made and created in the image and likeness of your heavenly Father. And that breaks any barrier, any classification that has been put on your life, either by a system or by individuals, by your colleagues, because God is jealous about his deposit in you. The Bible says in Genesis 2 and verse 7 that when God formed man out of the ground, the Bible says he breathed the breath of life in him and man became a living being. What that meant is all that God is, all that God will be, all that God will ever become was already deposited in you. You have divinity locked in humanity. And it is up to you to know how you are going to use that. It is up to you to know how you are going to harness that power that is put in your life by the breath of God. Our brother Peter, having worked with the Lord Jesus Christ, having seen the miracles, knowing that he had been empowered, then we are given power and authority to cast out demons, to heal all diseases, say this. That divine power now has been given to us. The one that we witness, John says they witness, as Jesus was moving around, that power that they witnessed now has been given to us for life and godliness. That means this. You don't have to be a procurement officer. Amen? So that you can get your kickback. That you can believe God and trust God and make your money honestly. You don't have to thrive in evil and corruption. Even when corruption hit the roof, you don't have to expect the money of blood in your life so that you can thrive. Because God has given us power to life. That your neighbor and tell your neighbor. God has given us power to life.
God has given us power to life.
And that means, my brother, brother, whatever it is that you want, whatever it is that you desire, God has given you the power to achieve it and to get it. Because all power and godliness has been given to you. When divinity, I want you to know this, that the power of God and the reality of God has already been locked in you.
The water had continued to flow in rivers for many years. And God had hidden in that power of, in that electricity.
But God did not create electricity. He wanted men to use the power that is in them to harness electricity. A horse can do a lot of wonders. It can run races. But in order for it to run races, that power needs to be harnessed. And God has given you a deposit. And that is a deposit of the Holy Spirit of God. And He wants you to use that power. But how do you use it? It must be by exercising the faith, the word of faith in you, because God wants you to be an overcomer. We were created and given the power to become over our circumstances and demonstrate God's power in us. Let me tell you, friends, it is until you have made a move that then God will manifest Himself. If you sit down and wait on God, let me assure you, 100%, you are not waiting on God. God has been waiting on you to take a step of faith. And it is not ignorant faith. It is not stupidity. It is not jumping from a rooftop. No, 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 no. It is not fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And saying, I am fasting and praying for 40 days and 40 nights so that I can know what to do. God has already given it to us. And what God has given to us, He has given us the desires locked in us. Do you know why we want good things? It's because when the Creator created everything, He looked back and evaluated. You know godliness? Godliness is evaluation of the things that you are doing and the things that you have done and looking back and saying, it is very good. It is very good. Until you get there, and when you get there, then you begin to manifest the glory of God and the likeness of God to the community. Because God created us so that we may show Him for His glory. Let me remind you something else. You are the crown of God's creation. You are the pinnacle. You are the splendor of God's creation. It does not matter what challenges and struggles you are going through. You are the crown. You are the crown. You are the glory of God's creation. You know why the hair is called the glory of the women? And why they spend a lot of money? No, no, not a lot. Why they spend some money? They spend just a little more in their salons. They spend a little more. They invest. I am yet to meet a woman who does not invest in her hair. Because the hair, the Bible says, is the glory of woman. Now, you are the glory of God. And God wants to show off. The reason why they did clear hair, I now understand, after the Lord blessed me with one and then followed me with a daughter, is because when they turn, their hair speaks. Their hair speaks. And so is their glory, because it brings out who they are. Before you see their dress, you see their hair. Now, God's purpose in your life is that you will be the glory, His glory in the community. That means when people look around, they will see you. When people look around, they will turn and ask, Allah. Because God is manifesting himself in your life. That your business is not the one that is struggling. You are not the one that is starting a business after another without headway. You are not the one in the street saying, I am jobless. We agreed sometimes back. Or I proposed as I suggested. Or I appealed to you. That there should nobody be nobody in this church who says, I am not employed. Because you should first and foremost employ yourself. Let the pride of your life and say, my responsibility is to provide food for myself and the people that God has given me. Let me give you a story. When we went to the United States of America, and I born again and wanting to go to heaven perpendicularly. That means as fast as I could. That was the testimony. You remember the testimonies we used to give in high school. That I'm born again, spirit filled, and I'm going to heaven perpendicularly. Everything else follows. So we go to America, and when we go to America, people are looking for jobs. But myself, because I had gone as a student then, and I would not be able to work, I was not legally allowed to work. And I am here, the people look for jobs, and they go to look for jobs and they get jobs. Including, I don't know whether they are here in this congregation. I'll not mention their names. But then they go looking for jobs. And I'm here in the house. I am not going out to look for a job. Because I am born again. I don't want to break the law. But then, I had a prophet in the house. He is Samuel, our second born. And he told me, Dad, you must choose whether to obey God or to obey the laws of men. Because any man that does not provide for his give food to his family, he's like a thug. He's like a robber. And I am telling you, friends, my godliness needed to be demonstrated that I am not a robber, that I am not a thug, that he was not getting the one infidel. But he got a robber, a thug, somebody who is very bad in the community. And I'm telling you, the following one day, that was on a Thursday, and the following one day I was out looking for a job. And sure enough, I got a job. Because I realized that God has given us all power for this life and godliness. And what is godliness? Godliness is your ability to know your challenges and how you should overcome them and provide for yourself and your family. That is why God never created ugali. Ask yourself some of these questions because they're very basic. Why God never created Uganda? Even why God never created the fire? Why God never created or brings to us children every, like when you get married and then the Lord says, you hear a knock at the door because God is bringing you children. It's because God gives you responsibility and work. Work it through. Because God has given us the power to work them through. In the book of Psalms chapter 8 and verse 3-8, there is a question that is an eternal question. What is man? Yani mwanadamu ni nini? Anazunguka zunguka, anapendana pendana, anazaza, anakufa, lakini mwanadamu ni nini? What is man? But God, you are mindful of him. I want us to see what the psalmist of Israel says with the revelation of God who man is. And he starts saying this, when I consider the heavens, let us start from verse 1. Psalms chapter 8 and from verse 1. I want you to ask yourself, who am I? Ask yourself, who am I? Ask your neighbor, who are you?
Then let's find out the answers.
Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth, who has set your glory above the heavens. Let me tell you, friends, if there is something that God is concerned about his glory. God is concerned about how you reveal him, how you show him up. God is concerned about how you demonstrate his reality and presence in your life. In your home, God is concerned about how you make your children understand who God is. You know, we are living in times when you tell them about God, they want to see God in you. If they don't see God in you, the other things you are telling them might not mean anything. Because children do what they see. And they rarely do that which they hear. You tell them, don't eat sugar. But they see you using sugar every day and putting it in your tea. And you are telling them, don't eat sugar. Explain to them why they should not eat sugar. Don't tell them not to eat sugar. They will eat sugar. They can see you eating it. And children, even in godliness, the reason why there are problems in homes is because you are telling them, do this, don't do this, don't do this. You are telling them, don't do what I do, but please do what I say. But that language is very foreign to them. They cannot understand that. Then the Bible says, O Lord our God, our excellent is your name in all the earth, who have set your glory above the heavens. What are the gates that you are putting in your home for showing further the glory of God? In your family, how are you setting the gates? How are you raising the standard in your home? That even your child, your baby, begins to see that we are a different family. We are not like our neighbors. No, we are a family with a distinction. Why? Because we do acknowledge that God has his glory in our home. Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have ordained strength because of your enemies, that you may silence the enemy and their victim. Why do you need to overcome the world? You need to overcome the world because you are living in a way of problems and skirmishes in Nairobi. There were people that were moving around with the crowds and they were selling tea to them. They knew there is a problem here. Somebody is going to get hungry. I need to wait for them somewhere. I need to cash on this cow. I need to milk the cow. Because they are going to get hungry and they need to be fed. So I am busy myself pursuing the purposes of God in my life and meeting a certain particular need, because that need, when I meet it, it will create my wealth. It will create my life. And the glory of God will be manifested because people will see my life is different. So he says this, out of the mouth of babes, you have ordained praise. And then the question is, what is man that you are mindful of him? And the son of man that you visit him? You have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. I told you. You are crowned for glory and honor. God wants to brag about you. God wants to do things in your life. The Bible says the eyes have not seen, neither has it entered the mind of man what God has in store for the people that love him. And that is yours. The promises of God can only be statements in the Bible until men and women rise up and say, I want a demonstration of the power of God. Because Peter is telling us that power that God gave us in creation, it has been given to us for life. How are you using your knowledge of God in your business? How are you using your knowledge of God in your school setting? How are you using the knowledge of God in raising your children? How are you using the knowledge of God in determining and marking your territory? The Bible says when Joshua was commissioned by God, he was told, wherever you go and you step on it, that place I will give you. How is your walk? What areas are you marking? in the middle of the night, what areas are you marking? Because the areas you mark, those ones God is going to give you. Why? Because God has given you dominion. Verse 6 says this, you have made him to have dominion over the works of your hand. You have put all things under his feet. All things under his feet. The moment you understand the power of God that is in you, you refuse to be contained in bondage. You refuse to be a slave. You refuse to be a servant for the sake of being a servant. You say, God, I want you to manifest yourself in my life. I want to have a legacy for my children. I want to have a legacy for my family. I want to be a doer in the house of God. That means I don't hold back anything when it comes to glorifying God in my community of faith. Let me tell you another thing that I have learned about Jews, because I have been learning about Jews, I've interacted with them. Now I don't normally hear about them. I don't read about them in the Bible. I interact with them and I want to understand their philosophy of life. And their philosophy of life is this. Even those that do not profess to believe in God, even the atheists and their Jews, they never use the 10%. The 10% that Abraham was commanded by God and gave to Melchizedek, that 10%, they never play with it. Even the racists, even the criminals, they never, because they believe this. It is the first aspect of breaking human greed and selfishness in your walk with God, as you seek to walk with God. And when you do that, then the windows of heaven open and they bless your life. The other day we had somebody in the U.S. who was accused of racism. And when he was trying to say how good he was, he said he gives 10% of his wealth, he was a billionaire, 10% of his wealth to his community. And besides that, he also gives the widows and the orphans, because that is God's command. And then he was saying, now for this, that is where I am. Why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this because of this. Many times we hold on to nothing. Many times we hold on to things that will not help us. You eat and rob God. And then expect it to twist the hand of God in one way so that God will bless you. Let me give you a secret. Let us reset ourselves. Because God has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Jesus demonstrated the power of the kingdom in the book of Matthew chapter 4 and verse 23. Remember in the book of Matthew, Jesus comes and announces the kingdom of God is at hand. But you know, the kingdom of God must go along with power. The kingdom of God must go along with authority. And that is the authority you and me have been given. It is the one that God, Jesus Christ, got back for us after it had been taken away by the devil during the time of the fall. And now that it is in us, Jesus Christ demonstrates and says this. When he moved in all Galilee, he taught them the word. He taught them the word. And by teaching them the word, he was informing them about God's power in them. That is what Peter is telling us in the book of 2 Peter, verse 3. That this divine power has been given to us. And then he was informing them. That means he informs them so that by information they are transformed. Instead of thinking as victims, they think themselves as victors. Instead of thinking themselves as losers, they see themselves as looters in the kingdom of God. Looters of the kingdom of the devil. Instead of seeing them as sick and maimed and unable, they see themselves empowered to do the business of the kingdom. And so he talks to them and he teaches them. After teaching them, they are formed. That means their minds are able to process the things of the kingdom. And then the Bible says, not only after teaching them, but then he does something else. he begins to preach. Preaching is proclaiming. Proclaiming of what are you telling others about yourself? What are you proclaiming? What are you declaring? Because what you decree, you become what you decree. And because you become what you decree, you must be careful about what you are saying. In this walk of faith, you must be careful about what you are decreeing, what you are saying. And then after decreeing, I want you to follow the process. Then the Bible says, and he healed all their sicknesses and all their diseases. You are the change agent God has positioned in your family. You are the change agent God has positioned in your institution. You are the change agent God has positioned in this church. Probably all you can do is pray. And prayer is the one that becomes the pillar of the body of believers. God is raising up an army. And God has a reward for those that are willing to be enlisted. Do you want a reward from the Lord that your children and your family is going to benefit from? God asks you, do not do anything whatsoever for nothing for God. God does not need volunteers. God needs men and women that are committed to the call. And when you are committed to the call, I can tell you, you'll be a shining star in the house of your God. In your family, you'll be an example. In your community, you'll have breakthrough. Let us rise up. This morning, as the Lord is speaking to us, you realize there are areas in your life that are struggled. Kuna pahali katika maisha yako, wewe unasikia umenaswa, umefungwa, you have been chained. And God wants to set you free today. Your business has been struggling. And it is because in your mind, about the knowledge of God and who God is to you, there is something that you, there is something that brings confusion. And God wants to unravel. God wants to zavala. That means God wants to set it loose. Because he wants you to walk free. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
If you are sick, it is not the will of God that you are sick. If you are unwell, you are struggling. God created you to manifest his image in your business. You have been the crown of God. God has crowned you with glory and honor, and it should be manifest. If you are in our midst and you have been struggling for too long, I want to tell you this. Weeping may have endured for the night, but your deliverance is here. You might have been struggling with sickness, but let me tell you today, your healing is here. There is a healing. There is a balm of healing in Gilead, and this is your moment. I want you to come to the altar. I want you to hold the pillars. I want you to hold the lail. I want, as it were, the Bible says, go and hold the horns of the altar until there is deliverance. Let me tell you today, there is a deliverance for you. If you are sick, if you are unwell, I want you to come forward and believe God for your healing in Jesus' name. I want you to come forward. I want you to come forward because there is healing today in the house of the Lord. There is deliverance today in the house of the Lord. There is a breakthrough, and if you miss it, you will miss it. Today is your day. Today is the day of your victory. Today is the day of your deliverance. I want you to hold the nail. I want you to hold the nail. I want you to believe God for your healing. I want you to believe God for your deliverance, because our God is a healer. Our God is a deliverer. Our God is a mighty man of war. Whatever devils have been fighting you, whatever challenges have been encountering in your life, I want to tell you that today is your day of deliverance. Today is your day of healing. The Bible says, and the Lord sent his word and the word healed them. Today, the word of God is going to heal you. God is activating. God is activating. God is activating the healing process in your life. God is activating a time of deliverance. God is activating a time of a miracle in your life. And what is a miracle? A miracle is a moment when God releases his divinity in you and the work of divinity in you so that your life is restored in Jesus' name. My Father and my God, in Jesus' name, I want to thank you for these men and women. I pray that you will touch them. I pray that you will touch them. I pray that you will touch them. I pray that they shall receive the anointing that breaks the yoke in the name of Jesus Christ. In their life, they shall be delivered. In their life, they shall be healed. Their organs are going to function. Their blood system is going to be clean. My Father and my God, in Jesus' name, touch your people. Let the power of God flow in their life, in Jesus' name. Receive your healing today. 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 In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Our Father and our God, I rebuke the power of Satan that had bound your people. I rebuke you, Satan, in the name of Jesus Christ, that you release these men and women from sicknesses, from bondage, that they shall be free to show forth the glory and the power of God in their lives. Receive your healing today, amen, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the church said amen.
Amen.
Let us give a mighty clap. As the people go down to sit, there is an area in your life. You don't feel sick, but there is a sickness in your spiritual world. There is a certain kind of demon that have been coming behind you, and everything that you do, you are not getting a breakthrough. I have come to tell you that your time of struggle has come to an end. I have come to tell you that you must thrive, because that is what God wants in your life. I want you to raise up your hand wherever you are for that issue, for that problem, for that challenge. I want you to raise up your hand. Because we believe in a God of miracles, we believe in a God of power, and God is wanting to partner with us. God is saying, come, little children, I have a plan for your life. I have victory for you. I have a plan set for you. Raise up your hands. Father, in Jesus' name, meet the need of your people. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.